my pleasure to introduce Professor Rajagopalan, who of course everybody knows here. He's been heading our innovation center here, and he's working on a number of different projects concerning GIS and so on. So Professor Rajagopalan has a background in GIS. He's been heading the KCST for what, about 10 years, right? He was
14 years.
14 years. Then he's also started the what was the
spatial data?
Spatial data a company called Spatial Data Associates. So they were one of the first to provide navigation for Bangalore City well before we had even heard of Google Maps, or when Google was not even on the horizon anytime. So today his talk would be about his analysis on BMTC data, which promises to be very interesting. So on to Professor Rajagopalan.
Thank you, Srinath. First, some caveats. BMTC runs about 7,000 buses. So if you see that, BMTC runs about 7,000 buses. One of the largest fleet operators in India. They have a information technology system which they call as intelligent transport system, which collects data about position and speed of the bus, every one of the 7,000 bus, at every 10 seconds. This is called the bus trace data. And this data is roughly about per month, somewhere between 250 to 300 gigabytes. So we took 3 months of that data, roughly about 1 terabyte. And since we do not have sufficient computing capacity to hold all the 1 terabyte data and do some analysis of it, we diced the data. We dice the data in many ways. One way is that we pick up data for a few hours or for a few days and do some analysis. Or we pick up a data for a few routes or one route and do some analysis. Or we pick up a geographical location like Silk Road and we do some analysis. So it is plainly not very satisfactory, in the sense that, you know, when you have got 1 terabyte data, we should hold all the 1 terabyte data and then do some analysis which will be meaningful. But hopefully with the facilities that is being planned for the Minro Center, we should be able to do that in the next 1 year. We should be able to. So what I am going to present to you is the work that was done in the last 3 years, starting 2016, not by me, obviously, by about 30 students. These were students who either took my GIS course and did as a part of the project work, or who did project elective with me. And what we had done is, all the 30 students' work did some amount of quality assessment, and whatever we felt we should give it to the outside world, we abstracted and prepared a volume this August, 4-5 months ago, called Driving the City. This has an abstract of some of the important works of the students. So today what I am going to present is 3 of these 30 works. And this, what we will do is, some of them would look fairly simple to you with the methodology or the findings, which is nothing great, you know, intuitively we know so much about Bangalore city traffic, but there are some important findings which I would highlight and why they are important also. So one of the problem with BMTC finds itself, and most citizens get annoyed, is this phenomena called bus bunching. That is, the buses schedule their frequency. Let's say that there is a bus called 356 CW Here it has a frequency of, let's say, 5 minutes, but sometime you will find 3 or 4 356 CW will go one after another, and then for next 30 minutes you will not see any one of them. And this phenomena of bus bunching is not unique to BMTC nor unique to India. It's universally observed. It's the same problem which London bus transport faces, same problem Berlin bus transport faces, same problem Boston faces. And this has been, a lot of people have tried to look at this phenomena of bus bunching and why and how one could get out of bus bunching. Bus bunching has got two serious problems. One is, for the commuter, he doesn't know when the next bus is going to come, because if he has come just after a bunch of buses have gone, his waiting time is pretty large. Second, for the corporation or the fleet owner, the revenue falls, because what happens is that after the first two or first bus which will go full, the next buses will go partly empty. And if the waiting time is pretty large after the one series of bunch has moved, the passenger tries to use some other way of commuting, auto or Ola or Uber, instead of waiting for long. So the corporation loses revenue and people get annoyed. So we first wanted to check whether bus bunching happens in Bangalore, how often, where. So what we did was, we just, as I said, we diced. One of the students did. He picked up the K4 route, which has 40 buses, 40 bus stops, and sufficiently large number of buses to understand. So this route is from C.V. Raman Nagar to Nagar Bhavi. C.V. Raman Nagar is towards the east of Bangalore, and Nagar Bhavi is west of Bangalore. So it cuts across from east to west. So we made some assumption. One is, the assumption is, what is meaning of bus bunching? Now we have to define it properly. And so what we defined was that if two buses are close to each other by 70 meter, then we said these buses are bunched. The question is, why 70 meters? Why not 100 meters or 50 meters? What we did is, there are 40 stops in this route. We identified the distance between two stops and which is the closest to two stops, and we took half of that to identify as the distance between two buses. If they come within 70 meters, then we consider them as bunching. And similarly, we also looked at the time when buses are involved in bunching. If the bus frequency is 15 minutes, any buses which come within 7.5 minutes, 2, 3, 4 buses, we would consider them to have bunched. There's, one is the 70 meter distance, another is the half the frequency. So if you plot this, if you plot it on the x-axis for a day, this is what we have given. This is for the day of 19th June 2016. And we have plotted on the y-axis all the bus stops, on the x-axis is the time, and different colors indicate different days. Well, for example, one color is 13th June, another color is 14th, green is 15th, red is 19th June. And you would find that whenever there are buses coming together, we have plotted, and then you would find that at different bus stops, there are bunching that takes place at various times. This is a simple filtering operation, nothing more than that. Use distance between buses. We have to calculate the distance between the buses using Haversine formula and things like that. But simple thing is that you take the entire data for this particular route and then filter it for 70 meters and 7.5 minutes, and then you plot this. What becomes interesting is, if I plot that across all the stops, I see a pattern here. The pattern is, once the bunching has formed, the bunch travels together. So you can see here, bunch travels together. See here, bunch travels together. So which basically means that bunching, once it is formed, does not resolve. They travel together like a convoy. And they travel together for significant distance. If you see this, they travel together from bus stop 21 to bus stop 40 on the left side. Almost half the distance they all travel together. Which basically indicates that it should be possible, if this pattern we can establish it for all the bus bunching situations in Bangalore for all the routes, if this is the pattern and once the bunching formed, it bunches together and it doesn't resolve very easily, we can then, if we can prove that, this is only for one route for a week, if I can prove it for all routes for larger amount of data, then we could possibly say that if the bunching occurs or when the bunching occurs, if possible, you terminate one of the trip and get the trip back to the origin. So at least next frequency, you are not going to suffer. Of course, that has practical implication. If somebody has got into the bus and has bought a ticket for stop number 39, and because it is bunching, you say the trip is terminated here, you get down, he is going to be annoyed. So we have to look at those issues. But one possibility is, if I also can show, later I will show that some of these processes are stationary. And if these processes are stationary, I could even say that in the schedule itself for this time, you say that this is a cut service. I don't know how many of you are from Chennai here. In Chennai, they have this concept called cut service, where a route, the same with the route number being the same, the destination will be reduced. Like for example, if it goes from Tambaram to Paris Corner, they might simply say this trip goes from Tambaram to Carnegie statue or something. That's one way of trying to resolve bus bunching, and with real-time solutions being available, because ITS handles it, gets it in real-time, it should be possible to intervene. Yeah.
This kind of corrective measures, and we also have online preventive measures to keep the distance between the buses
Starting time, delay in the starting time is a possibility. But then the problem is that you publish a frequency. You say that bus will come every 15 minutes. So people will expect the bus to come in every 15 minutes. So what is happening is, because of bunching, from some stops, the frequency gets completely altered and people have to wait for longer. So one way of thing is to broadcast saying that we are going to delay this bus by 5 minutes or 10 minutes or whatever, and broadcast it sufficiently widely. That's a possibility which one can do. That is easy to do. That's the easiest to do. The question comes is, as Sachit said, when I know that my previous bus is within some striking range, what do I do? Do I just park the bus or do I go slow? What do I do if I am already started the trip? If I have not started the trip, yes, I can postpone. Yeah.
Why does bus bunching happen in the first place? Given that everything,
we'll come to it, because I have another study which looks at congestion. It is basically because of the congestion. Congestion is not continuous. It starts occurring at some point in time and starts dissolving at some point in time. So if the first bus has not faced congestion and has gone to these 20 stops, and then as there is a severe congestion, its speed is low, and the second bus does not face congestion till the 21st stop, then that will come and join this. Yeah.
Sir, is one show doing one-way bunching, or is it two-way bunching? I mean, from two to two and four.
This we have only plotted from, in this slide I am showing only 1 to 40 stops. 40 to 1 also we can show. But bunching will happen there at a different points in time. Yeah.
starting.
Yeah, from that point. So sometimes what people do is when say 3-4 buses are arriving at the destination at the same time, they stop the buses and then they release the buses only after every 15 minutes if the frequency is 15 minutes. So the second, third, fourth driver has a extended break at the destination. But this basically is something which is bothering almost. In fact, if you look at the international journals, Transportation B and Transportation F, you find the number of people who are trying to model this and trying to provide solution is, but still it is a persistent problem across the world. It's not only that. What we plan to, we thought that once we get a slightly more powerful computing, this is for one route for 1 week. We could do for all routes for 1 week and then see that whether the bunching as a phenomena is takes place at the same time for all routes or different routes exhibit different bunching times. Second, we can also look at is the bunching more concentrated spatially in some parts of the city. If it's all concentrated at various other places, we can then say that what need to be done. But this is one which we thought we'll show. So this is another same thing. What we did is to look at bus bunching at across 1 week data. Yeah.
Isn't bunching primarily a result of some static timetables that you want
that
typically need power for? And even the timetables are very, very unrealistic. They make some assumption about average speed through the city, and then that's the basis on which they
see what they normally do. I'll give you. Yeah.
So it's really not surprising that bunching actually happens.
See, what normally transporters all over the world they do is, while drawing up the schedule, they have different methods. In Bangalore, they use something called a Form 4. In fact, we are trying to see if Form 4 could be automated in some respect. So in the Form 4, what they say is that this is the starting point, this is the ending point, these are the bus stops that are there. And then they have an idea of, it is not completely static, they have an idea based on the analysis of past data, how much minutes it takes to cross a kilometer at a particular point in time. Like they would say that at morning 6 o'clock it is 1 minute per kilometer. And in Bangalore I have seen in some segment they have gone up to 2.5 minutes to a kilometer at some point in time, say 10 o'clock in the morning. So they estimate the total trip time based on these assumptions, saying 1 kilometer, 1 minute to a kilometer. So if the trip is 40 kilometers, they would say that this will take so many minutes for the first trip, second trip so many minutes, third trip so many minutes, and that is how they bring the schedule. So if the detailed schedule in Form 4 will actually say this is the starting time, this is the time at which this bus is expected to be at various bus stops, and this is how it will be. And they try to make the starting time uniform at every 15 minutes or whatever. But what normally happens is these assumptions are not holding good. When they say that at morning 10 o'clock a kilometer will take 2.5 minutes, actually takes 5 minutes.
Yeah. Everywhere.
But only thing what somebody told me is in Ahmedabad, where they have a dedicated corridor on outer ring road, there it does not happen because that is more like a train. So they have made bus stops like a railway stations and you have a dedicated corridor for a train. So there the behavior of the buses is more like the behavior of metro rail or something like that. Whereas but in Delhi, when they did the dedicated corridor, it did not work. Because the dedicated corridor was not cordoned off. So there were cars, auto rickshaws, everything came onto the dedicated corridor. But in Ahmedabad, I am told it works. Only in that place, no? That system is there only on the ring road.
In Jakarta, do they have dedicated bus lane? Jakarta, the traffic is terrible. From just wondering if there was any insight on
I haven't looked at Jakarta. Yeah.
It's just a bus.
Recently, I had an opportunity to look at Ulaanbaatar data, which is a much smaller town. or Ulaanbaatar also exhibits the same kind of thing. Anyway, let me just go to the. So this is another such plot which we show. Next is the one of the reason for bunching is congestion. So we did some work on congestion. So I'll just present what did we find. Again here, because of one, these projects have all been should be finished as a term paper or a project within that 16 weeks which we have. Second is that our data is really large, you know, 1 terabyte cleaning and hosting and doing analysis was difficult. Here also we did some kind of filtering out and then just to see the flavor of this. So what we did was that here we did time-wise. We picked up time 9 to 10 and then we needed to define a congestion. What do you mean by congestion? Somebody has to define that. So we took a definition ourselves. We said if the bus speed is less than 5 kilometer per hour, then it is congestion. And another assumption we made was that the bus speed is an indication of the speed of every other vehicle there. If bus speed is 5 kilometer per hour, I would say that a car or a three-wheeler or a two-wheeler also faces congestion. This is just an assumption we made because very rarely you will find bus faces congestion and nobody else faces congestion. And then what we also did was we filtered out bus speeds near bus stops, bus speeds near traffic signals. Because they may be slowing to stop at the bus stop as well as slowing to stop at a red signal. They pick up the same thing. No, they pick up phone data. They pick up bus data from BMTC. In addition to bus data, they have Ola data. Uber doesn't share it with them. They have Ola data and then they have the phone data. These are the three. And they also use the same kind of yardstick, red, amber, green. So we did this and we filtered this and what we did was when we identified points on the map which where the congestion takes place, then we did a clustering of those points. We used a routine DB scan kind of clustering and then what we did is we for each of the cluster we just drew a polygon covering all the points in the cluster. Our idea was to see that these polygons, do they shift with time? That our thing was, if the polygons are fairly stable, that if we find that the say, polygon area as well as location at 9 o'clock every morning happens only in these places, and if I can show it for 40 days, it happens in the same places, then I can say that the congestion is somewhat predictable. The process seems to be predictable. Whereas if the polygons shift around locations, then it is difficult to predict where and how congestion will take place. So that's what we did. So here is one kind of a plot where we identified all the points where congestion takes place between 9 and 10 on a given day. All those red points or all the points, each of them will be multiple points of points where congestion takes place. Huh? Pardon?
No, I'm just saying that it will be fully red.
And these are cluster centroids kind of stuff which we did at various locations. On though I have put a color green, it's all places which are higher congested, that is speed less than 5 kilometer per hour, and 40 clusters we had identified between 9 and 10. 40 locations in Bangalore, clusters, that means multiple locations, each having clusters with some cluster mean and some cluster boundary. These clusters had congestion issues. And we basically said for clustering, we said the minimum there should be 20 points which are there in the sample, and they should all fall within the distance of 500 meters. Yeah, 2016 data. We also have 2018 data, but I am presenting 2016 data. 2018 data we have got. So if I run the same study for 2018 data, then 2018 August September data we have. So we can then find out whether metro has helped. 2016 there was some metro in some parts, but not fully. 2017 the whole metro started. We can have a look at it. So this one area of such clusters. And what we did was that for 2 days we just looked at BTM and silk board, you know, from all these 40 clusters we said let me just focus, zoom in on to And what we did was we constructed the polygon. If you see those polygons, there are three colors there, you know, on top. Each one is a polygon size between 9 and 10 where the clustering of the congestion has taken place. And they are actually overlapping. That means the polygons here, they are either bigger or smaller, but the congestion is for 3 days or so, they are all in the same place. It's the polygon itself is fairly well defined. That also shows that congestion hotspots can be taken, though we have done only for 3 days. If I can repeat it for, let's say, all the 90 days or even 2018, if I find that these convex hull polygons all have their centroid at roughly the same within 500 meters of each other, then we can come to a conclusion that congestion hotspots are permanent congestion hotspots in those times. And I can also start in, I was asking Jaya that is it possible for me if I do this for 9 to 10, 10 to 11 or even shorter duration, 9 to 9:30, 9:30 to 10 like that, some kind of animation can be done on the visualization to show that how these congestions shift. How do they create, how do they dissolve? Because the size of the polygon will keep increasing as the congestion increases, and then it will reduce when the congestion decreases. So some kind of an animation visualization on the data can be built. So the same thing we did it for July 5th. Then this is the work which I want to now take maybe next 15 minutes. After that we could have questions and answers. Any questions on this? Because I want to present this and then have the question, because this is also on congestion. We have not looked into it. We had that on mind, which is called congestion travel. Congestion travel, what we normally can do is that you start lag time between congestion between nearest neighbors. Like for example, if there is a congestion at Silkboard Junction, then there is a congestion at let's say St. John's Medical College Junction. And if I can observe that one has a lag period of, say, T, and this lag period is kind of stationary over periods of days, and whenever congestion happens, delta T later or T later, the congestion happens there, then I could also provide some kind of spatial correlation between them. And then I can actually fit a model saying how does the congestion travel. We have not done that. Yeah. I understand that, but we have no traffic volume data. In fact, Dinesh's work has to become citywide to get traffic volume data, because we only have CCTV frames. from CCTV frames to data, Dinesh has done some algorithm, he has tested it for electronic city, seems to work, but we need to productionize it in some kind of a large scale to see is it possible for us to count type of vehicle, number of vehicle. Currently, we have no traffic count data for Bangalore. Traffic count data for Bangalore is done on a survey basis maybe once in 5 years for a particular project. Like, for example, when they did the detailed project report for Bangalore Metro, they did a traffic count data. Similarly, when they wanted to do the 2031 master plan for Bangalore, they did a traffic count data over 2 days, and then they say this is what is the traffic count for the whole year. But currently we have close to some 1,300 cameras in Bangalore CCTV. That data comes to various traffic control centers. So if that could be some way by which I could count and then convert those frames into databases, that would be useful. Then I could do this. What you are saying? Yes, sir.
Yes, the congestion those plots that you
do, yeah,
should it be a little more nuanced, because the congestion is directional, isn't it? You have, at this time you have congestion in this direction, but not in the other opposing direction. So you're not showing that.
Okay. We have basically, as I said, our thing was wherever the bus, I did not put a parameter of bus direction in addition to bus speed. But that's eminently possible because the trace gives me bearing. So I can also say bearing and speed. It's eminently possible saying that this congestion is towards what directions.
Your underlying model is congestion based on lat long or is there a graph model?
Lat long.
So you don't have the data which are the other intersections from which it is leading to?
Yeah, we have to construct the flow model from this data, which is a very difficult exercise to have because we have 5,700 plus bus stops in Bangalore. And we also have this one-way, two-way, various restrictions. So we have to first construct that graph. Somewhere it is bidirectional, somewhere it is unidirectional. And then I have to use this data to count the, to compute the flow model. Possible, it's nothing this, but we did not attempt to do that because for us this itself takes lot of effort and time in cleaning up the data and then doing things like that. In fact, currently we are looking at ticket sales data and doing something. So this work was a RE work with me by Kanika Narayan. This we actually wanted to check. Is congestion stationary in Bangalore as a stationary statistical series, or is it has some stochastic properties? Because if I can prove that congestion can be stationary as a series, statistical series, in a time series analysis stuff, then we can look into the patterns. Then we can look into the causes of that and solutions for it. If the congestion is not a stationary series and there is stochastic element, I cannot suggest a kind of a management solution, an engineering or a management solution. So we wanted to see that whether congestion in Bangalore can be modeled as a simple stationary time series. So for this purpose, what we took was, we wanted to basically find out, we transpose the problem saying that if I can construct a time series of a particular route, bus, speeds, now not time, instantaneous speeds, because we have the instantaneous speeds for every bus, every 10 seconds, which I assume to be instantaneous speed. So is it possible for me to take all those speeds over 45 days and then look that up as a kind of a time series and then see whether I can model this time series. If I can prove that this time series can be modeled in a very stationary way, that also shows that bus speeds are predictable. And if the bus speeds are predictable, I can predict that when the congestion will happen and from there where the congestion will happen. So what we did was that we picked up this route 227 NA, this is the vehicle number, and that is from Madhapatna to KR Market, 30 kilometers. And we took data from 1st July to 19th July, you know, it's a 20-day kind of data. And we had also assumed which is holiday, which is a bank holiday, which is something in that period to see if there is any effect because of holidays, etc. And then what we did was that to check whether the model, what we propose as a model is reasonably good, we get these AIC and BIC. The lower AIC and BIC actually says whether the model is reasonably good or not, whether it is not over-specified. So these, we computed these statistics for the model which we wanted to do. And this is just a plot of all the speeds. Every 10 seconds we have got the speed for that particular bus. So starting from 1st of that day till 19th of July, for every single instance, for every 10 seconds, we have plotted the bus speeds. Yeah, yeah, it has touched 120. Yeah, yeah. We can check that out. Then what we did was that we first did to see whether this series as we have presented is stationary. We used the Dickey-Fuller test and computed that statistics, and then we found that this time series is stationary series. That was our first test, whether this series is stationary or whether null hypothesis is that time series is non-stationary. And we proved that it is stationary. Because if it is stationary, then I can say what model fits this stationary series. What kind of time series model which we will undertake. So what we did was we looked at, we wanted to see if there is any trend or seasonality. So we looked at, plotted the graph for rolling mean and rolling standard deviation, which are virtually parallel to x-axis, you could see that. So there is not much great variation in rolling mean and rolling standard deviation, which also means that I could go ahead and model this. Yeah.
This data includes holidays.
Yeah, it includes holidays. It includes complete. It includes all. We wanted to see if there is any effect of holidays, but you don't see.
So, one, I mean, just for example, December, you have a season of 4 days.
This is actually omits that because we are 1st July to 19th July here. It may be interesting to see if I take some other time. 1st July to 19th July is, except for Saturday, Sunday, bank holiday kind of stuff, there are no festivals. We also wanted to study when there are no festivals and things like that. Which is, monsoon doesn't seem to have any effect on this. Yeah, yeah, just see this graph, no? So what we did was that we decomposed it. You can see the daily seasonality. There is a seasonality on a daily basis, you could see in the second graph, but we don't have a trend. This might come as surprising, you know, seasonality, everybody will agree that at 9 o'clock, the speed comes down at, you know, near midnight, the speed is high, etc. That seasonality is available. But what it shows is that is no trend line. Once I remove the seasonality from my speeds, the speeds are more or less highly predictable. That is, it is not in those 19 days, I did not see any trend. Maybe if I plot 365 days, there may be a trend. Those 19 days, there was no trend. Or maybe if I plot for 1,000 days, I might see a trend.
But why would you even expect a trend in the long term?
See, that, Intuitively, people are saying that Bangalore traffic is slowing down.
Oh, that way, okay. No, but that you wouldn't observe in 19 days, right?
We won't observe in 19 days or 20 days. That's why I'm saying now, since BMTC has the data for 4 years now, if somebody could crunch 4 year data, I could see, is there a, what I could possibly do is that just take every Monday data and see. Is there a trend over 4 years? That's a possibility. One can do that. One can get the data from BMTC for every Monday for 4 years and then do the same kind of analysis to see if there is a trend. But in these 20 days, there was a daily seasonality, but no trend. Yeah, yeah, all.
Even that there's no trend.
There is a daily seasonality, but no trend. So next one, what we did was we tried to look at the autocorrelation function for in a time series to say speed at time t, how does it affect time t plus 1, t plus 2, t plus 3. And this autocorrelation function, when we did the plot, after somewhere about 2 or 3 logs, the effect is barely minimum. That basically shows that there is no very clear impact of the time of the day on the speed. So otherwise, it should, autocorrelation should show up that time of the day. It has for the t, the first data, but first data does not seem to influence. It influences a bit on the second data, but not further. So you will find it get attenuated very fast. This is KR market to, what is that place? I'll tell you. KR market goes to some Banapura or some such. 30.5 kilometers from KR market. Yeah, it is from KR market. So it is traversing through the heart of the city in that sense. But I can tell you what is the route also. Yeah.
So with the hack, if there is serious correlation,
yeah,
because lag time series
T minus two, it seems to influence. T minus three onwards, influence is very little.
If, for example, it is just T minus greater than, then you think that the bus bunching problem and this one are related.
Yeah. We wanted to check that also. We wanted to check whether bus bunching is related to these kinds of phenomena. But here our focus has essentially been, is it possible for me to say that given a particular time of the day to predict how accurately I can predict a bus speed at a bus particular location? That is just, we just plotted the, we basically took the T by this then band. No, that we just took the two lags from the third lag, that is the band in which all the other attenuation takes place. That's all. There's no other significance.
But doesn't this basically mean your entire time series is just white noise?
Huh? Beyond the two lag.
Beyond the two.
Very localized, etc. Which basically is fairly interesting, no? It basically means a speed of the bus at a particular time t does not, is completely uncorrelated with just 20 seconds before. We are talking about 10 second intervals, which I thought is interesting because it's counterintuitive. Yeah.
Yeah. Unless bus driver drives a different seat, but your problem drives as well as I can.
Yeah.
Yeah, but it's very hard to understand because here it says the performance of the bus is highly influenced by outside environment. But then the bus also reached 120 kilometers per hour speed. So how is it able to get it into reality?
Instant, that's.
Yeah. Yeah.
So anyway, I'll show you some more way of grouping this. We did some cluster, this thing. I'll show you how results came. Now, you wanted to ask something.
I was just wondering if the number of traffic signals in a given route and the duration of the traffic signal, does it interact in any way with congestion, with speed?
Those times, the bus speed will drop to zero at the traffic signal when it is red. But to model traffic signals and its influence on instantaneous bus speed could be done. We have sufficient data for it. We do not have the data of location of all traffic signals and the time in which it operates, because some traffic signals start only at 7:30 in the morning, they go off at 9:30. We need those kinds of data and then filter those timings out from the time series what we have.
Bangalore has a peculiar traffic management. They have red lights for 90 seconds.
120, 180. Yeah, that will be interesting to look at. Yeah.
Across stops, then it went to a train.
No, this is actually across stop. This is because this is for 20 days all time for that particular bus. One single bus for 20 days all time. That means it is traversing in that route up and down. So we also looked at the partial autocorrelation function. You can find that, you know, significant values only till lag 2. Beyond that, it does not have much significant value. So what we did was that we tried to model with autoregressive or moving average models this thing and try to see how well they fit, to what level of lag we can do this, use this. So this is one model which we try to fit, where I have basically taken T-1 and T-2, and then the WT is the error term. This is one model which we estimated. Yeah.
Yeah, so those TSDF plots that you showed, I mean, that is typically what you would expect out of the residue after you've done all your modeling. So when you want to verify that your model does as best as it can, you remove whatever you've been able to predict using that model.
That's,
and whatever is remaining,
we plot it in that.
You plot it, and if it looks like white noise, you basically say, yeah, my model is the best that it can do. And then, so whatever is remaining is something that cannot be modeled.
Hmm.
But you're already showing that it cannot be modeled. It is like white noise.
Beyond lag 2.
Beyond lag
2. No. With up till lag 2, it can be modeled. Beyond lag 2, it is not modeled. It's white noise. That was the idea of those plots. So, that's why I have taken here only two terms, T-1 and T-2. And if you really look at it, this is the equation we got for the best fit and RMSE of 10.45, and this is the kind of, the yellow one is our predicted value and the blue ones are the real values. This is with autoregression with two lag model. So this is various statistics about that model and what is the kind of standard deviation and other such parameters which we have got.
No.
Delta? 10 seconds. In this, we have got three way of doing this modeling, and this is 10 seconds. Yeah, I'll show you how, what we did. So we did three different kinds of modeling. Here we did instantaneous model. AIC, BIC values are pretty high, as you can see. Then we did a moving average, because we didn't have a good prediction as well as good AIC, BIC value with just autoregression. We did an autoregression and moving average model with the 4-2 term, where theta 1 and theta 2 are the moving averages for those T-1 and T-2. And this, you would see that when I plot this, not much improvements, except that we have a slightly better error terms and things like that. But you will find that there are some values which predicts negative also in this, negative speeds. Yeah.
The modeling is basically a second order differential equation.
what you are saying.
Yeah, that we also did that. In fact, I wanted to show you the steps by which we went and finally saw that there may be a better model than this. And this is a summary of that model. You would find that slight improvement on AIC, BIC values, but not much great stuff. So what we did was that we did, the first two lines are the model values for instantaneous, the delta t 10 seconds. Then the next one what we did was that we basically said is that if I average out speech for every 5 minutes, because I have 20 days, each day 24 hours, 24 into 12 time interval. So every 5 minutes if I average it out, what do I get? So I am not predicting instantaneous speed now. I am trying to predict 5-minute interval, what are the speeds. And I did again that as autoregressive only with two terms and autoregressive moving average. We got some better values for RMSC and better values for AIC and BIC. Then what we did was, we separated out the data is three sets of data. One is where the speed is less than 10 kilometer per hour. Another one is 10 to 20 kilometer per hour and more than 20 kilometer per hour. And each one of these we fitted as a separate time series. There are three time series instead of one time series. And we did that for that stuff. And then we found that we are able to get much better things than that slow moving and free flow. ARMA, autoregressive moving average for 4-2 with two groups of slow moving and this thing, it gives us much better performance. So this is the kind of final model which we achieve, saying that this is the kind of function. The idea of doing this was not to really look at which model fits me better. The idea here was, if I can show this I have picked up one route. If I can show that for all the routes, similar models could be computed with roughly the same coefficients, with same kind of outputs and same kind of things, then it is possible for me to model the entire BMTC as a time deterministic stationary model. But for that, we need to run this kind of exercise for every single bus route. That's what we are going to do. This semester some student is working on that. This is basically temporal. Now we want to bring in spatial temporal. So we are saying for all routes passing through silk board, 1 kilometer around silk board, what is the speeds, time series of the average speeds. That somebody will be doing this. Because what we eventually want to do is it possible for me to model the whole Bangalore traffic as a spatio-temporal stationary model. So if I can show that the traffic speeds are spatio-temporally stationary and not stochastic, then it shows that they are amenable to managerial and engineering solutions. And if you really looked at my earlier congestion, which is what I was telling BMTC people sometime, the congestion points which we had identified for those days, which I can do it even for today, they are nowhere near the elevated route which they are planning from Shivananda Circle to Hebbal. If you really look at the congestion points and they want to do something, the things are west of Cord Road. The Cord Road is one. Second is from the Mayo Hall to Whitefield. And third is Varthur to Silk Board. These are the ones repeatedly in congestion. So, yeah.
What is again, we are talking about the speed of the BMTC. It might be congestions around the bus stops.
No, we have removed the bus stop data and the traffic signal data. So this is all when they are driving, really.
Okay.
we filter out bus stop and traffic signal, because speeds will come. That's why you didn't see any zero speed. Otherwise, there will be a lot of zero speeds in that data. So I'll stop here. I'll just, any comments, questions, what we can do next? Yes, Janki.
I don't know if this data
it's 6-4 years, Bangalore traffic data. Actually speaking, it is 8 years. 2010, we started getting Bangalore traffic data on the internet, but for wide use, it's about 4-5 years.
So there
We could take a look at it. We could look at instantaneous speed or the average 5-minute average speed of buses after Ola was introduced or Uber was introduced, and then see whether any changes happened. But my gut feeling is nothing would have happened, because they carry 5 million passengers a day, these 7,000 buses. We are, Ola and Uber put together might carry, 1 million passengers a day, or even that is difficult. They are totally 100,000 or 200,000 vehicles. Yeah. You are basically saying that, is it possible for me to say that, how is the decision making of individuals affect the overall congestion? That's your basic question. There are people who have attempted in the past multi-agent system modeling to do congestion. They have not given very good results, because there you are supposed to put up a logical model. The logical model will be of this nature, saying that what is the behavior of an agent if he sees congestion ahead. If he gets an information that Silk Board is heavily congested, is what say FM broadcast or your Google Map says, then are you likely to reroute yourself to some other route? If so, how is that decision made if you are an individual? Are you going to follow a Google driving directions, navigation left to Google algorithm? Yeah. Yeah, but what some of them do is that, like for example, Google navigational algorithm, though the algorithm, nobody knows what is it, but they are reputed to have seen directing people in such a way that they minimize overall travel time. That algorithm is supposed to taking the real-time information and then decisions of many people and then say that, what would happen? I think that kind of algorithms will work well when at least 50-60% of people who are taking decisions follows those navigation guidelines. If it's going to be less than 10% following those guidelines, those, you are likely to end up with that paradox where people finding, Silk Board is going to be congested today, let me take another route and congest St. John's Medical College. Yeah, yes, Kavita.
Buses usually have a fixed route, and those, or Ola, or any of these follow, they tend to be a lot of people who should be not used by some. So actually what happens is that use of smaller roads by these algorithms
unfortunately will lead to bottlenecks there, which will then propagate through major roads. you can see that it also depends upon the road width. We have some data of the road width. We have some data on the road width. So we have to actually take the road width also into account in modeling some of this, so that we could say that by our decisions of navigating, giving navigational directions in something, how does the road width impact and what is going to be my cascading congestion because of my decisions. Because I see now they find that Malleshwaram to Majestic gets congested, so they start routing everybody to Shirampuram and RC Puram and things like that, which are all basically old residential areas with 30-foot roads, 10-meter road width. On 10-meter road width, you get directed by Google and things like that. You will only delay stuff. Yeah.
So your data actually showed that there were a lot of white noise and streets were correlated only with nearby streets. But then you built a model based on that near causality. But how well will such a model be predicting the longer term performance?
We have been able to predict reasonably accurately using this what is going to be the speed at a given time on that route.
Or will the errors accumulate over time?
No, doesn't seem to, because what we did was this time also one student is doing. So what we are doing is that we take first 20 days as test data, the next 10 train data, and the next 20 days same route as test data, and then we see that how is the prediction, etc. Seems to be reasonably okay. Not. But what I am saying is, will it hold good when I open it up for all the routes, all the days? Or is it peculiarity of this particular route?
No, what you said might work. So I might be able to build a model on the first 20 days and for the next 20 days. But I guess Srinath's question is about, if I know the speed over the last 5 minutes, can I predict what the speed will be?
Next 10 minutes.
That I don't think will work because your autocorrelation is
in place. That stops after 20 seconds.
Yeah.
One question I had is, so currently what is the role of this intelligent transport system? One is definitely collecting data and use, but then finally where is it getting used? Is it being used?
They want help of people like you in automating Form 4. That is their first task. They have something called Form 4, which actually says what is the route of, I have not shown that. They operate about 2000 routes. And some of the routes are highly overlapping. 90% of some routes will overlap with other routes. So one is rationalization of these routes. Second is how do I automate Form 4 where I say this should be the schedules of the buses, starting time, starting place. In that route, so that avoid bus bunching, maximize passenger count. And so we are doing some more work on that. Murali has a student who works with Murali on Form 4. Murali is not here today, but somebody is there with him who works on Form 4. But what we are also trying to look at is, we are trying to see that what is the ticket sale like? Do we need 7,000 buses in Bangalore in the first place? What has been the ticket sale like? We have also started getting some data from Metro Rail of their, what they call as the footfall data. That is how many people has entered the station or exited that particular station. That data we have got. So we are trying to see that whether it is possible for us to look at the ticket sale data and the routes to see that is it possible for us to rationalize. Because some roads have really become choked because of the number of routes you can't widen the road, but so many buses ply on that route. So that's another problem which they face. So we are trying to do a few things, but hopefully those things we can fairly clearly tell them something only when we are able to take hold of this entire data and do some analysis. You know, it's not one route, one location, one date or something like that. We need to show that this model works fairly effectively with at least, if not all the 2,500 routes, at least for 200, 300 important routes. Like by ticket sales, if I arrange routes, say 100 top routes of Bangalore, and then I am able to do something for those 100 top routes. Yeah, yes, Sridhar. Yeah. In fact, at some point, where is Prasanna has walked out? Prasanna at one point did Chandrasekhar, his MS student, did a study without data, of course, they just modeled. Is it possible to do something called dynamic routing? The concept of dynamic routing has been tried out in smaller towns in the world where you don't have any fixed schedule, fixed routes are not there. No fixed routes. It's a kind of a share Ola or share Uber, but except for 5 people, it is 20 to 40 people. 40 people or something. So you just send a SMS or some way by which you say, I want to travel from this bus stop to this bus stop. All bus stops are numbered. So you just say, then it will tell you that some bus number so and so will pick you up at this time and will drop you at that place at this. It might take any route, pick up passengers on the way, etc. In fact, it was also tested out in a Chinese city about 4 years ago. They abandoned it after about 2-3 months. Not so much because of any problem with the model and things like that, but problem with the prank calls. They had a large number of requests saying, I want to go from here to there, and nobody was there. So they were dynamically routing buses and finding no passengers. So they had to give up that. But there have been some attempt at dynamic. Prasanna did one exercise, MS student Chandrasekhar, where they said that with some request patterns, they said 2,000 buses in Bangalore with a seating capacity of 20 should be sufficient to take care of this kind of dynamic. Okay, yeah.
So, congestion problems. So, one is what DFTC, in this kind of analysis, what DFTC can do to change. Probably most fundamentally, there's something on the infrastructure side that was the issue. Fundamentally, the capacity of the road is lower than, and then there are bottlenecks that you created permanently there for some time. Anytime a 3-lane becomes a 2-lane, you guarantee to have a congestion piling up at peak traffic time. That seems to be.
See, what we thought we could use this to say is, if you want to do engineering solutions, which are your candidate places?
So, sorry, is there some other data you can also which you give like, which you give some indicators, this is where the throughput is not possible given the current?
That is only the closed circuit CCTV data. If we can get convert the CCTV images to data, then I will get where the throughput is high, where the throughput is low, at what point in time, where is it, I can even track the speeds. I can use the BMTC data to get the instantaneous speeds and then say speed up till here was fairly okay, but then it became slow. So that means there is something else there. So then we could find out candidate locations for improvements. The improvements in terms of, widening the road or doing something else, removing a signal or making it one way. How are the decisions made to say that this road will become one way? It is made basically based on some kind of observation and some intuition. Like for example, Kempegowda road is one way. It is 6-lane. It's a 6-lane one way road. And there is no congestion on Kempegowda road. It's very high speed throughput. The road is wider than what the capacity is, except during Friday night or something when everybody wants to get out of the city and thousands of buses come there. Other than that, so that's basically the thing is that congestion and public transport has become a kind of top research area across the world. In fact, on transportation, there are ABCDEF journals. One of them look only these kinds of stuff because what they find is that especially in Europe, when multiple ways of transport is available, they would like to see that which one they need to put money on. Should it be on autobahn, or should it be on metro, or should it be on buses, should it be on elevated or underground? Berlin has 6 modes of transport, public transport. So they use things like this. But they more now have moved away from this kind of analysis to simulation and gaming. Use these data, these analysis to build simulation models. And then see what happens in it. So we, in fact, I suggested to one student that he should try to install MATSIM. We don't have a copy of MATSIM in the institute, but it's open source. Download, install, and run. And see, use some of these model parameters in MATSIM and see. Okay, thank you.